We're going to, over the next few weeks, get into a series on Christmas, on Advent, and leading up to Christmas. And you know, as I've been reading and studying a bit about this, I learned that in Advent is Christmas, for that matter. The way you celebrate Advent or Christmas, that's nothing you're going to find in the Bible. Okay, there's no biblical prescription for how you do the Advent or Christmas. These are things that we celebrate that have been developed throughout time and history by people in church. Okay, and technically, Advent and Christmas are two different seasons. There's an Advent season, which would start on this particular Sunday, leading up to Christmas Eve. And then the Christmas season technically starts then. Once Advent season drops off at Christmas Eve, Christmas season starts on December 25th and goes through January 6th. And I've heard some of you around here talk about Old Christmas, which must have its roots then in this tradition. Now, of course, what we do is kind of a hybrid, okay, with Advent and Christmas together. We're celebrating Advent and Christmas, and they're just kind of tied together here over the next few weeks. And you know, once December 25th and those few days afterwards get here, come and go, we're all kind of looking towards New Year's, right? And getting back to work and all these kind of things. So we're kind of a hybrid thing here, and over the next few weeks, we'll study and talk about the themes of the Advent candles. We'll talk about the expectation or hope of Christmas. We'll talk about the love of Christmas, the joy of Christmas, the peace of Christmas, and the Christ of Christmas. These will be the things that we talk about between now and our Christmas Eve service. And so that's what we have to look forward to. Today, our focus will be on the expectation of Christmas. And I've taken to referring to it as the expectation of Christmas versus the hope of Christmas for reasons that I'll explain in just a few minutes. But we're going to be studying today from Psalm 62, verses 5 through 7. Psalm 62, verses 5 through 7. This is a Psalm of David, and it says this: "My soul, wait in silence for God only, for my hope is from Him. He only is my rock and my salvation, my stronghold. I shall not be shaken. On God my salvation and my glory rest. The rock of my strength, my refuge, is in God." Let's pray. Father, I'm grateful that we have the opportunity to study today and over the next few weeks, looking ahead to Christmas, this time that we celebrate you taking on flesh and coming to this world. Father, I pray that as we study these particular elements, that you will give us insight and understanding that helps us, Father, to live for your glory, to reflect you more, to bring you honor and glory in all that we do. That's the purpose. The purpose is not to necessarily understand our human tradition. The purpose is to understand you, understand the you behind this. So, Father, I pray that as we study in particular today on the expectation of Christmas, that you'll help us to understand and make application into what we talk about today. So in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So the first thing we'll dive into here, guys, is to talk about the expectation of Christmas, is that we wait with silent expectation for God. We wait with silent expectation for God. And there in verse 5, David writes, "My soul, wait in silence for God only." And so as he talks about this idea of waiting for God, it's carrying with it the weight of and the understanding of expectation, hoping, So his soul is waiting in expectation for God. His soul is waiting in hope for God. And that's certainly an application that we want to make, that we want to understand as we're talking about the expectation of Christmas. And we can understand expectation around Christmas time, can't we? It doesn't take a Christian to have expectation at Christmas time. As the world, people who have no idea who Jesus is, but they have an idea who Santa Claus is, they have expectation at Christmas time, right? This is something that we can identify with, that people all over can identify with as we think of whatever their idea of Christmas is. Anticipation certainly rules the day of Christmas. People are anticipating what Santa Claus might bring. People are anticipating gatherings with friends. People are anticipating perhaps a nice vacation at Christmas time, some time off work. There's tons of anticipation at this time of year. And certainly we would understand that anticipation kind of underlines expectation. When we talk about expectation, the expectation of Christmas, there is an anticipation that we understand rolls with that's part of the package of expectation. So, there are some differences, gladly, that we need to understand and recognize that exist between us and the world as we talk about the expectation of Christmas. The first one that we see here in this particular verse is that our expectation, our anticipation, our hope is not in Santa Claus or family gatherings or time off work. Those things are fine to be excited about. Okay? Those are tangents. Those are ancillary things as to what our expectation should be about. And David says, my soul wait in silence for God only. You see, our expectation at Christmas is for God. Should be for God. This is what we should be expecting. This is what should drive our expectation and our hope. This idea of expectation of God and for God is what drives the Old Testament. What drives everything you read throughout the Old Testament scriptures is the expectation of a coming Messiah. And that's what Christmas is. Christmas is the delivery of this Messiah, the one who would come to save the world. And so you read all through the Old Testament scriptures. You read what we're reading today in Psalm 62, and David's expectation, his hope, is in God and God only. And so as we look at that, we make that application then as we look at Christmas, we can kind of go back and celebrate, acknowledge the way that the folks in the Old Testament times were expecting a Messiah, and we kind of put ourselves in that place as we build towards the day that we celebrate as Jesus coming to this earth, as Jesus being born. And we kind of adapt that same type of expectation for the coming Messiah. So that's part of the expectation, as we just kind of put ourselves in those shoes of those who are waiting for the first coming of Messiah. And that drives some of our expectation of Christmas. But also then for us, we expect and we look ahead, just like the folks in the Old Testament were looking ahead to his first coming then. We expect and we look ahead to his second coming. And so this is the expectation of Christmas. So what are some of the things that we should be thinking about and hoping for and expecting and driving our expectation at Christmas? Not so much gifts, not so much parties, not so much time off. But we should be thinking about his first coming and what it meant and what it means, and his second coming and what it will mean. These are things that should be driving our thinking and our praying, our thoughtfulness during these weeks. And those are good things to focus on. There's a second difference that you'll see, that some of you probably picked up on, as we talk about the expectation of Christmas and kind of the difference between the world and the way that we are called to expect Christmas. David writes that his soul waits in what? Silence. Is silence something you really associate with the coming of Christmas? That the world associates with the coming of Christmas? No. It's hustle and bustle, isn't it? It's getting ready. It's buying this and buying that and doing all this shopping and being at the stores at 6 o'clock in the evening on Thanksgiving Day. And you gotta hurry through your dinner so you can get to the stores. That's not waiting in silence for Christmas, is it? And you know, getting your house just so and your decorations just right and planning when you're gonna do this and when you're gonna do that. I mean, your schedule can just get so crazy and hustle and bustle and time crunches. These are the things that seem to dictate what Christmas means to so many people. And it can certainly seep into our lives and dictate the expectation. For many, then when we start expecting Christmas, for many people, it becomes a drudgery. It becomes, oh gosh, we're gonna be so busy and we gotta do this. We won't even have any time really to celebrate what it really means. But David says here, the expectation in God is one where we wait in silence. See what that just does for you? Just those few seconds. Try again. Just settles things. Settles things. When we wait inside. And that's just the elementary understanding of what we're talking about here. What David is talking about when he talks about waiting in silence. Because you see, as we wait in silence for God, as we expect God in silence, some of the things then that we apply, some of the things that we do, perhaps, surely it means our focus is on Him. So we take time and we understand that even though there's going to be stuff going on around us, okay? There are going to be things that we do and things that we participate in that are fine. Okay, I'm not saying we don't do parties and don't have people at your house. I'm not saying that, okay? But if we can truly learn to focus on God during these times, and maybe there are things that we need to do to be able to do that. Perhaps we, during this time, when there is so much competition going on around us, so many things that will make it difficult to wait in silence, with this expectation of God, perhaps we do need to focus a little more on our prayer life during this time. Perhaps we do need to focus a little bit more on carving out some time and saying, this is going to be the time. Maybe normally you don't do that. Maybe normally you don't need to say that every day at 7 in the morning or 8 in the morning or 8 at night or whatever it is. Maybe you don't normally need to do that. But maybe at this time of year when we're looking at the expectation of Christmas and trying to wait in silence and truly see what it means and understand who God is and understand His coming first and His coming second, maybe this is a time where over the next 3 or 4 weeks, I do have to say, and you do have to say, this is going to be the time where I wait in silence and talk to God and hear from God. See, that's one of the things of waiting in silence. When I'm waiting in silence is when I can hear Him and receive His instruction and receive His direction. So maybe this is the time to do that. Maybe you don't normally fast. Maybe this is a time where you can take a day, a couple days, a couple meals, a meal each day, whatever it is, and fast. Because when we fast, we are by nature then removing ourselves and setting ourselves apart to hear from God. And remember, we've talked some in the past, you know, fasting can be so much more than fasting from a meal. Maybe you can fast from a day of shopping. Maybe you can fast from a week of activities or a couple of days of activities. Whatever it may be, there are many different ways that you can approach this. But the key, and this is one of the things that I'm saying that separates us from the world, is that we don't want to embrace necessarily the hustle and bustle of Christmas. As we wait with expectation, we want to embrace waiting in silence. Waiting in silence. Find some time to do this and see how it will impact your Christmas. Next thing that we see as we move on through these verses is that we wait with expectation because he is our hope. So the end of verse 5 says, "For my hope is from him." And the beautiful thing that we understand about biblical hope, biblical expectation, it's so much better than what the word hope has come to mean in our everyday language. But you see, biblical hope has a certainty to it. But when you or I think about hope in our world today and what it has come to mean, there's certainly not a certainty associated with hope, is it? Usually when you say, "Well, I hope this happens," are you saying with certainty that that's going to happen? No. You know, if I say I hope that the Redskins win today, I'm certainly not saying with certainty that the Redskins are going to win. And if you're a Cowboys fan, you have a whole lot less certainty. But that's the idea. You know, when we talk about hope in our world today, there's no certainty that's associated with it. But when we talk about our hope being rooted in God, there's a certainty. There's an absolute certainty because I'm saying my hope then is in him. And because my hope is in him and I understand about him that he always has been, that he is, and he always will be, there's no lack of certainty there. This is God, the one true living God. This is what I understand about him. He's the one true living God. He always has been and he always will be. That's something you want to put your hope in. He has not failed. He has not broken any promises to anybody. He's not made mistakes. This is where you want your hope to rest. And I can then have an expectation based on this hope, an expectation which is rooted then in certainty because he is a certain and true God. This is real hope, my friends. This is real hope. This is not putting my hope in something that is fleeting. This is not putting my hope in other people, even because people will disappoint us. God will not disappoint. This is not putting my hope in alcohol or drugs or any other thing, but the one true living God. And with that, there is a certainty. He is the hope for us, and praise him that we understand it. That I can say that, as I've said before, that probably I can speak for most of us here, that we get that he is our hope. But check this out. He is also the hope for all the world. He is the only hope there is for the world. Even if they don't acknowledge it, even if people don't understand that, he is their hope. And part of our call then, and guess what happens if we can approach Christmas with correct expectations, and as we've just talked about, wait in silence and understand the differences there. If we can approach Christmas in the right way, maybe it then just even opens some doors for us to help communicate to our friends and neighbors who may not know this hope, that they can see that there is a hope and that he is real, and that this is the hope that they are searching for, because everyone's searching for this hope. Even if they don't know exactly what to call it or exactly what to look for. But our expectation, we can wait with expectation because he is our hope. We move on and we see that we can wait with expectation because he is our rock. Verse 6, read verse 6 and 7, we'll see this language. He only is my rock and my salvation. My stronghold, I shall not be shaken. On God, my salvation and my glory rest, the rock of my strength. My refuge is in God. Friends, do we need a rock in our lives today? Do you need a rock in this world that we live in? The world, man, we can look at the news, we can look around us, and we can think, wow, what a chaotic world. a chaotic world, when you don't know if a man's supposed to go to the men's bathroom or not. What bathroom are you supposed to go to anymore? Right? I mean, what a chaotic world. We look at a world in our world in particular, we see, as we talked about a few weeks ago, so much, it seems racial tensions coming back to the surface. Maybe they never went away. We see that. We see chaos and terror and attacks in our world. And we look around, and if you have no hope, if you have no expectation, if you don't have a rock, do you think this might be fearful? Do you think you just might think that there's no hope? Do you think that you just might feel like you have no reason to live? And that's the reality for a lot of folks who don't know that God is my rock. Because you see, with all this chaos, it is kind of like a storm. And when you think of storms, man, they can wipe you away. But if you have a rock to hold on to, if you have a rock to find refuge in, have this place of safety during the storm, then you can make it through that. And that's what David is saying here. David is saying that God is my rock. You see, David is writing this psalm from a context and from a perspective of being attacked by his enemies. Even as he's being attacked, even as he is under fire, taking it from all sides, guess what he says? God is my hope. God is my rock. God is my rock. I find myself in this tenuous position, but God is my rock. And so, you know, for us, then we can wait with expectation. We can look with expectation. We can live our lives with expectation when we understand and embrace that God is our rock. He's our rock. I can hold to him. David says here that God only is his rock. And certainly this is something we want to pay attention to. That God only is my rock. Because often we can get lulled into thinking, well, yeah, God is a rock for me. God is my rock. But I also like to take this prescription medicine over here. God is my rock, but I also like to, hey, depend on this person over here. Not that God doesn't use medicine or God can't use people to help us. God is my rock, but I'm also a pretty good rock at times, too. I want to trust my own strength. I want to trust my own words, my own thoughts, my own knowledge to make it through this. And so we can get in this place where we're thinking, yeah, God is my rock, but then I got this rock over here and this rock over here and this rock over here. You ever try holding on to 3 or 4 different rocks during a storm? Guess what's going to happen to you? You can get washed away. You're going to get washed away. You think, we might think that we're safer, but hey, I got 3 rocks, man. I got 4 rocks to hold on to. But if you try to hold on to all of them, you're going to get washed away. You see, there's only one rock. And David understands that when he says that God only is his rock. And when we know we have a rock that has stood the test of eternity, that's the one that you want to hold on to. That's the one that you want to trust. That's the one that you can depend on. And likewise, then, as we look at the chaos in our world and holding on to the rock, he makes the final statement in verse 7 that God is his refuge. God is his refuge. And that's, we can wait with expectation because God is our refuge. Tying into this illustration of the rock. And when you think of refuge, you think of a safe place, right? You think that when I'm thinking of refuge, I'm thinking of safety. I'm thinking of security. And that ties right in to God as rock, God as refuge. Maybe you even envision that, you know, you got a big old rock here, and in the rock there's a cave. You go even deeper into the rock, and you feel even safer. And that's somewhat of the imagery that is described here. God being my refuge, my safe place. Now, I'm safe and secure wherever, and to say and to stand on His rock, His word, on Him, that there's safety and security there. One final thing I want you to see. Notice that in these few verses that we've studied today, David doesn't say that God is a hope, or a rock, or a stronghold, or a glory, or a strength, or a refuge. He doesn't say that God is one among many. That God is one rock among many rocks. God is one refuge among many refuges. God is one stronghold among many strongholds. God is one salvation among many salvations. He doesn't say that. David doesn't even say that God is the rock. That God is the salvation. That God is the stronghold. Even though that would be correct. It would be correct to say it in as much as we're saying, you know, if you look at someone and say, hey, you are the man. You're saying, you're the man that stands out among all, right? You are the one and only. And if we say that about God, God, you are the rock. You are the one and only. That would be correct, right? God, you are the salvation. You are the one and only salvation. Salvation is only in you. You are the stronghold. These would all be correct statements. But guess what? Satan can say that. Satan does say this. Yeah, he's God. He's God. But Satan doesn't bow to him, does he? Because Satan can acknowledge that doesn't mean that Satan is saved. There have been plenty of people out there say, yeah, I believe in God. They acknowledge God. They think God exists. But there's a whole lot of people in hell who have thought, yeah, I believe in God. He is God. You see, the difference is that David doesn't say he's a rock, a stronghold, a salvation, or the rock, or the stronghold, or the salvation. David says he is my rock. He is my hope. He is my salvation. He is my stronghold. And as we talk about the expectation of Christmas, don't you think that perhaps God's expectation of Christmas, God's expectation of taking on flesh, coming to the earth in the form of a baby, going to the cross to die, don't you think His expectation of Christmas is that He did that so that He would be your God? Your rock. Your salvation. Your hope. Your glory. See, God's desire is not that you sit here and think, well, yeah, he is the God, he is the rock, he is the salvation. His desire, his expectation for you, for me, for each of us, is to be able to say that He is my God. He is my rock. He is my salvation. He is my hope. He is my glory. He is my stronghold. He is my refuge. So the question today is simple. Is He personal to you? Is He yours? Can you say He is mine? Let's pray. Father, we're grateful to have been able to study the scripture this morning and start talking some about Christmas as we talk about the expectation here. That seemingly all the world over knows about the expectation, anticipation that arises with Christmas time. Father, I pray that as we understand the true expectation of Christmas, that we can make application in our lives, that we can use this, Father, to grow in our own relationships with You, to perhaps help others to grow in relationship with You, that we can understand Your desire, God, your thinking when it comes to the expectation of Christmas, that, that you did that with the expectation that you would become a personal God to us, that we would know you, have a relationship with you, because that's what you desire. Father, I pray that we can certainly have our hope in you, and trust you as our rock, and trust you as our refuge. It's in Jesus' name we pray.